The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Hello and welcome to another edition of My Music, in which questions about music are answered by two people whose business is music, assisted by two other people whose business is manifestly not music. I refer to David Franklin, assisted by Frank Muir, and Ian Wallace, assisted by Denis Norden.
Which is good. Can you say which is good?
We begin with some orchestral music of the kind that our American friends call semi-classical. One mark for the title, another mark for the composer, and we begin, as always, with David Franklin.
Is written by Strauss Johann Zweiter, yeah. And it's called Morgenblätter.
Yes, translated meaning?
Well, Times, Telegraph, Mirror.
Yes.
Morning papers.
Morning papers.
Another one called Abendblätter.
Really?
It means evening papers.
Do you know that the Icelandic word for journalist is a blithermeister?
Yeah, charming.
Isn't that satisfying?
Yes. Well, I am your blithermeister on this show.
How many marks do I get?
I award David 1 + 1 = 2. Thank you very much.
You.
And some music for Denis Norden to identify.
Usually hears this kind of thing while a voice is saying, and here is Deirdre wearing the new topless see-through evening gown that we call Moonlight Madonna. Now,
you.
I don't know whether this was originally Moonlight Madonna, but I only know it as a song called My Beautiful Moonlight Madonna.
Yeah, it's so well known as that that I must give it to you. It was originally Poem, was the original title, by the other mark?
No other mark.
They always say on the radio, Poem by Fibish.
Do they? They don't always say that.
Yeah. I've listened to radio all my life. I've never heard Fibish.
Well,
I've heard the piece.
Well, anyway, one mark for Denis Norden out of two. Ian Wallace's turn.
Wasn't that very nice? Yes, I was waiting for the voice to come in.
With the title.
I wasn't going to be tempted in myself because it was just a little bit on the high side for me. Unless I am wrong, that is a serenade from the Fair Maid of Perth by a chap called Bizet.
Right for two marks. Right. Frank Muir's turn.
I've come across this several times. It was originally the theme music for a marvellous musical act called Wilson, Keppel and Betty. And also the words were put to it by Dickie Murdoch.
Yes.
I think it started off with, my grandmother, Eloise Wilkinson.
Well, my vote, his, I thought it was, my Aunt Fanny had a haberdashery, but now she lives at Burton-on-Trent. That's the one I remember, Vicky.
Clergymen eat tripe on Thursday? I mean, it's Belle-Egyptienne.
Yes, rather difficult composer. Can you get that for the other mark?
No, of course not. A bit foolish. The faintest idea.
Well, never mind. You'll get some easy ones later on.
Thank you very much.
Luigini.
Oh,
yes. One mark out of two.
Luigini finished.
Yes. The other week, you were very good on nursery rhymes. So we're going to try you on children's books. One mark for the name of the book, another for who wrote it, and a third mark for the name of the singer, or perhaps reciter. So three marks at stake, and we begin with David.
Beautiful soup, so rich and green, waiting in a hot tureen. Who for such dainties would not stoop? Soup of the evening, beautiful soup.
Inspired casting, I think, don't you?
Mm. Is it anything to do with a town called Alice?
Yes, it is.
It's Alice in Wonderland.
Yes, that's right, for one mark.
In that case, the author is Lewis Carroll.
Or...
What?
It's funny. Looking for his real
Dodson,
name.
Dodson of Dodson and Young.
Well, all right. Yes.
And
Dodson,
singer. The singer.
Beautiful. So it was very good.
No idea. It wasn't Joan Sutherland. Frankie Howard.
You're right. It wasn't
Frankie Howard.
Yes, Frankie Howard for your third mark. Another children's epic, this time for Dennis.
The sun is peeping through the trees and the birds are beginning to sing. Ah, a little wooden figure is coming down the path. He's whistling to himself.
The next voice you hear will be the voice of...
No, that's Last Exit to Toyland. That's one of the noddy... I don't know which one of the... Is it one of the noddy... And he was coming along with his little head nodding and his little... little bell having a tinkle, yeah. Noddy. Big Ears, yes. Meet Abbott and Costello.
No. you're near enough to it. Noddy meets Big Ears. Mark there by
Enid Blyton.
And the voice there?
I didn't know that voice at all.
Well, it was, in fact, for interest, Enid Blyton herself speaking.
Oh, jolly D.
Two marks. Two marks out of three. Ian's turn.
See, my love, what a beautiful pussy you are. What a beautiful pussy you are.
The owl and the pussycat went to sea in a beautiful pea-green boat. Yes,
from Nonsense Songs
by Edward Lear.
For your second mark. Singer?
I wasn't listening. It wasn't the gentleman with the small guitar.
No, it wasn't deeper than that.
Direct from his great success on Bladen Racecourse.
Yes, I thought it's Branny, Owen Branigan.
Yes, Owen Branigan, all right, yes, three marks there. And Frank's turn.
They said if you teasel, a sneasel, a weasel, a measle may easily grow. But humor or pleasel, the weasel or sneasel, the measle will certainly go. They expounded the reasons for sneasels and weasels, the appearance of measles when new. They said if you freezel in drafts and in breezels, then sneasels may even ensue.
The unmistakable voice of Dick Bentley.
Yes.
Whom you wrote
10 million words in your time, did you not? Let's take it from here.
Yeah, 8 million words the same. I don't know what he was at.
But you don't know the book it comes from, do you?
Milne.
Oh, Milne, madam.
Yes, initials, please.
A-A.
A-A Milne, I would accept it comes from the book Now We Are Six. Questions arising out of the storylines or subject matter of famous operas. David Franklin, the hero's initials were B.F. For British audiences, they were changed to F.B. Later, they were changed back to B.F. Who was he?
Pinkerton.
Yes.
Lieutenant Pinkerton in Butterfly by Puccini. He was stationed then, or at least his ship was in port, in Nagasaki.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We don't really need the entire story of Madame Butterfly.
Well, I'm quite willing to give it to you.
Do you know what his initials stood for in each case? BF, FB?
Benjamin Franklin.
Yes. Lieutenant Benjamin Franklin Pinkerton became, for the English version originally, do you know?
Do I get any more marks?
Oh, no, you don't. No, I'll tell you. Sir Francis Blummy Pinkerton. But after the failure of the first production, they changed it back again on the basis of who cares anyway. 2 marks out of 2, David, thank you. Denis Norden, who sings an anvil chorus and in which opera?
Well, while I'm saying a blacksmith, Ian is working very hard here with the slide rule.
sliding further and further into trouble. Anvil chorus. Well, the chorus sings it for a start.
Oh,
they do.
That's a likely story. Yes.
It's not one of my operas, but I have a feeling it's Trovatore.
Yes, that's right. For one mark. A chorus of what?
Not blacksmiths.
Well, I'm instructed not on any account to accept blacksmiths.
No, I think that's...
Forgers.
Have a half mark by telling me who will compose a real Trovatore.
Verdi,
yes. 1.5 out of 2. The operative word I wanted was gypsies. They are gypsies. Singing the anvil chorus. Ian Wallace, where do you find a character named Khrushchev?
Oh, I'm going through agonies here because I've come across this quite recently.
I should name the first Russian opera you think of, if I were you.
The first Russian opera I think of.
That'll take some time, won't it?
Boris Godunov.
Aha, you've got a
mark. Which is the correct one, I think.
Yes, that's
by
right.
By Mussorgsky.
Yes.
And he is a character in it.
Yes. I rather helped you. I think 1.5 would be...
Oh, yes, I'm
the funny thing is, actually, I think it's funny, Mr. Khrushchev is actually a nobleman and a tsarist supporter in the opera. Is enough reason for a subsequent Khrushchev to have changed his name, I would have thought. But 1.5 out of 2 there. Frank, in which opera is an old man turned into a youth, and what is the price he pays? Telling by your colleague,
keep him
will you?
Is very... the opera is quite a well-known one. Much admired.
Message is through.
Oh! Fust!
Yeah. Tell me Fust.
Dr. Forster.
Yes.
First written as a short story. Known as Getting Goethe's Garter. And then it was adapted into an opera by Gounod. Yes. Dr. Faust.
And what is the price he pays for...
Ah, well, you see, he bargained his soul.
Yes.
For all these delights.
His eternal soul, two marks. Show tunes, something a little bit lighter. David, name the show, please, and who played the leading male role in London?
How to handle a woman. Mark me well, I will tell you, sir, the way to handle a woman is to love her simply. Love her.
All right, you're so clever with your Gounod and your Verdi. Go on, you're on your own. I know the answer, but I'm not going to help you. Go on.
Don't mean you can't write.
No, I know the answer. What do you think it is?
Well, no, they don't have any nonsense about it.
No.
I mean, when Dennis doesn't know the answer, Ian just answers.
In other words, you give up.
Go on. Imitate my voice.
Try.
That's Camelot.
There were various chats.
I beg your pardon, David, you said it's...
Camelot.
You sound more like yourself.
Sid Camelot.
Yes. How you treat a woman as you love her. And the singer, the various chaps sang it over here.
Who played the leading male role in London? You know the name I'm after, Frank.
Harvey.
Yes.
Lawrence Harvey.
Well, your side came up with the answer, did it not? Certainly, 2 marks. Mm-hmm. Dennis, name the show, please, in your case, and the name of the chief male character in the show.
Taught her everything she knows. I taught her everything she knows. She sings like a bird. Yes, indeed. But who used to stand there and feed her the seed?
That's funny girl.
Yes, what? And the leading male character in the show.
What, who played the name?
No, the name of the character.
Well, the name of the character was a gambler.
Yes.
Who was founded on real life gambler, and who called Nicky Arnstein.
Yes. And who in the London stage production, just for interest, do you remember?
No, I know. I think Sidney Chaplin played it at one time, but I
yes,
think
that was
wasn't that on Broadway?
Michael Craig.
Michael Craig.
You got two marks. Ian, name of the opera and please the name of the singer we hear singing.
A brooding silence falls over me when I hear that.
My friend knows it.
Yeah. I expect your friend does know it.
My friend doesn't.
Yes. Sorry, you're always so helpful to me. You know.
Amendment.
If I can give you a
French
cigarette
friend
or something.
Thinks he knows it.
Would you like a throat pastel?
No, that would only make my ignorance all the clearer.
My friend knows the singer as well.
Well, yeah. I can tell you what your friend can do. I have a feeling the singer might be Joan Hammond.
No, the first name's right, but not the second name. Joan...
Joan Cross?
No, I can't give any more chances. Joan Sutherland.
Oh, Joan Sutherland?
The singer, yes. The opera sounds like the name of a ship, I always think. Sounds like the name of a ship.
Sounds like the name of a ship. You mean the opera sounds like the name of a ship?
Yes, not the singer, yeah. The opera.
Shylock.
Lollipop.
Skylark.
No. That's the good ship, I beg your pardon.
I think we've reached the end of the line.
We've reached the end of the line.
We're in harbour. Maritana, the... opera?
That's by Wallace, isn't it?
Yes, oddly enough, but a different Wallace, yes.
Yes. Oh, very different. I don't know. I don't even know his opera.
William Vincent Wallace.
Yes.
Frank, the name of the impresario, please, who put the show on, and the name of the author.
I was never kissed before in that kind of way.
I know that one.
Yeah. I know that one.
We all know that one.
He knew that one, but I do.
He knew it before the records started. Yeah.
The name of the piece was Bless the Bride, written by Sir Alan Herbert, words, yeah. And Vivian Ellis, music.
And
wasn't it one of Cochrane's last?
Yes.
Sir Charles. Tough at the top.
Cochrane, yes, probably. Charles Cochrane. Two marks. This is going to be a very quick round. This is about television series, old and new. What I want is the name of the show and the name of the leading actor. And David, it's your turn first.
Ah. That is Maigret, and the leading actor is Rupert Davis.
Two marks, thank you. Dennis.
I start crying even when I heard that. What always killed me about Dr. Kildare was he always dealt with, like, homicidal maniacs and people with suicidal tendencies. Oh, I had the feeling if somebody came to him with a sore throat, he wouldn't know what to do. Dr. Kildare,
yes, thank
played
you.
By Richard Chamberlain, yes. Now having a go at Hamlet.
Yes.
Not with a knife.
Ian, your turn.
We think this is Perry Mason.
Yes, you're right. For a mark in the leading.
That means Mr. Raymond Burr.
Yes. Frank Muir, your turn.
Steptoe and Son.
Yes.
Written by Goldman Simpson, the music written by Ron Grainer.
Yes, but the leading
characters, Wilfred Bramble, Harry H. Corbett.
Thank you for your 2 marks. Graham Dalley plays the start of a well-known song. When he stops, you carry on with the words as well as the music. Slightly different now. 1 mark for the tune, a 2nd mark for the words and new departure, a 3rd bonus mark for not going back to the beginning of the song. Which I've been trying to get you to do for 4 years.
Too difficult. Don't play.
So, I repeat. Pick up where he leaves off. David Franklin.
Left me on my own EO, all by the phone EO. I'd like to catch him with his nice new dolly. Then up would go Antonio with his ice cream brolly.
Oh, we're very good.
Well, they may not be exactly the words you've got on the card.
Well, I was going to say, 1 mark for picking it up in the right place, another word mark for getting the music right, and a 3rd mark for improving on the words considerably. with his new sweetheart, up will go Antonio with his ice cream cart, is the original. Anyway, 3 marks, good. Denis Norden's turn.
Bye.
Good one. Start again.
Bye, bye, bye. It's in there somewhere.
Bye, bye, bye.
Where somebody waits for me, sugar's sweet, so is she. Bye, bye, blackbird. No one else can love or understand me. Oh, what hard luck stories they... Oh, I'm trailing away. Noticeably.
I think you've done enough to win.
Yeah.
I've got the only single I know who sings in a bunch of keys.
Yes.
Terrible thing is it's all inside me. It's fine from where I sit. You know, it's when it comes out it goes wrong.
Would you, Denis, like 3 marks or would you prefer half a mark a key? take the 3 marks, I think, there. The last phrase, make my bed and light the light, I'll arrive late tonight, blackbird, bye-bye. Ian Wallace.
The Scottish soldier. He comes from Aberdeen, he has na got a bean. The Scottish soldier, his name is Andy, his legs aren't bandy. This is very difficult because, you see, this is a song that is really the property in Scotland of 2 lots of people. One is Andy Stewart on one side and those who do an imitation of him on the other. And I don't, unfortunately, belong to either of these groups of people. So that's about the best I can do. But it is the Scottish soldier. I started where you meant me to start. I sang some words. I sang some new words.
And if you don't give them a mark, you'll have the whole Scottish Nationalist Party.
Did you really think you started where I wanted to? I thought you went back to the beginning again.
No, because he went right through it. He goes... And then you came in again, the Scottish soldier.
Yes, but it comes in, there was none bolder, with good broad shoulder, you see. That's what you should have sung there. Anyway, a mark for doing that, a mark for the tune, no marks for the words. Frank.
And skies above are clear again. Let us sing a song of cheer again. Happy days are here again.
I'll buy that. Thank you. And I'm afraid the end of the programme is here again. And this week, it's a victory by 3 marks for David Franklin and Frank Muir.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Race. questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the teams.
Yes, My Music again. We may not be the best show on the air, but we think we have the tallest cast. If the five of us were laid end to end along the King's Road, Chelsea, it's doubtful if anyone would even notice. But just for interest, we would stretch for over 30 feet. Had you thought of that? Over 30 feet. Incredible. Well, while the listeners assimilate that fact, I'll just run through the names. Frank Muir is partnered by David Franklin. Denis Norden is helped by Ian Wallace. Would you believe that? We begin with music from the stage. Two marks for just simply the title of the piece. David Franklin.
Well, come on.
You wouldn't like to... still stretched out in the King's Road. Would you like to play me something else, would you?
No, I'm afraid we're stuck with that one, maybe.
This is Slavonic.
The dance of the... I bet it's a dance of the...
But it is Slavonic, isn't it?
It is a dance of the... I'll tell you that.
That's right. It's a dance of something Slavonic.
Well, no, that would mislead you. It's a dance of the something.
But it's Slavonic music.
In origin, yes.
Yeah.
I only asked you for the title, you know, not the composer or the national...
I know, but all of these steps are terribly necessary before one makes a decision. I've come to a decision. I don't know.
Well, will the real David Franklin please sit down? It was the dance of the tumblers from, incidentally, The Snow Maiden by Rimsky-Korsakov.
Yeah.
Denis Norden.
Well, the moving finger is writing. The words that are written here. What? Go pack, which is some kind of picnic basket, obviously.
What's that word? Sorochki.
Sorrow Chastity Fair. Or.
Not Chastity.
Chasky.
Chinsky.
Sorochinsky Fair.
Really?
Well.
That's really going about it the hard way. It comes from the Nutcracker Suite.
I see. It was a go-pack, wasn't it?
No, it was a different kind of pack, actually. Try a different sort of pack.
Tre-pack.
Yes.
Like right. Compact to Surrender. No.
And, well, yes, the alternative title I would have accepted, Russian Dance. But there we are.
Tre-pack, I would have given it to her.
You've got it in the end. One and a half out of two, I think, after so many false starts. Ian's turn.
It's a waltz.
I won't deny that. No, I won't deny
it. It's from an operetta.
Yes.
And
I don't know that I'm prepared to go much further than that. Of course, you want the title, don't you? Otherwise, we don't get a mark at all.
No, that's right. This is the reason we didn't ask for composers in this round, because virtually nobody knows the composer of this piece. I can tell you, his name was Drigo. Ricardo Drigo.
Drigo.
Yes, but the name of the piece escapes you.
Mm. Well, it's not anything to do with gypsies.
Oh.
No.
Harlequin's Millions is the English translation of the title. Dance bands call it Millions of Harlequins. Les Millions d'Harlequin, is it? Anyway, mm-hmm. Harlequin's Millions from the Serenade from. No marks there. Frank Muir's turn. Well, those are the words. Now, what's it called?
Oh, it isn't the singing round.
No.
Oh, no.
No, not yet. Not yet.
Don't know.
No. Chardas from Coppelia by Delibes. No marks.
If you'd asked me to dance it, it would have been different.
And we turn with some relief to the subject of opera.
You're relief for you, mate.
I was certain quarters. Yeah.
The name of the aria, the name of the opera, whence it comes, and the name of the composer. So it's three marks, and we begin with David.
Bits of information you require, Mr. Race?
Aria, opera, composer.
Aria, una furtiva lacrima. Opera,
yes.
L'Elisa d'Amore.
Oh, it's
composer,
every word's a pearl, isn't it?
Donizetti.
Absolutely marvellous.
Yeah. 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 Any of them left?
Yes, indeed. Three marks. Thank
now
you.
Now comes a sickening thud.
All right, let's see. Dennis.
Of course, the awful part that if it wasn't for Donald Pierce, I wouldn't know this either. It's the Barcarolle from the Tales of Hoffmann by Offenbach.
Yes, three good solid marks. Ian, your turn.
Name of aria, vice d'arte, usually translated in English, music and art, these have I lived for, sung by Tosca, the opera singer, in the opera of that name, by Puccini.
Thank you for three marks. Yes. Frank, try this one perhaps without help, I think. See how you get on.
It's a Toreador having a go there, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes.
From the opera Carmen.
Yes.
The libretto was French, and the composer was Bizet.
Bizet, yes. Three marks. Ian, how sound is your knowledge of jazz?
unsound.
Well, you'll be glad to know this next round has nothing to do with jazz at all. Yes. Just general musical knowledge.
You really frightened me there for a moment. I wondered what was coming.
David, an English pianist, transcribed a chorale from Bach's Church Cantata number 147. Can you name that piano piece and the arranger?
It's lovely to see the boy work, isn't it? Don't stick a pencil up your nose. You might not get it down.
How can you carry on back with that part?
I don't know. It just takes a bit of thought out of my head.
Try for the pianist, or the title. Well, I'll tell you one and you tell me the other. Would you like the title or the pianist arranger?
Give me the title.
The title, Jesu Joy of Man's Desiring. Now arranged by...
Now give me the name of the pianist.
I must, I'm afraid, Dame Myra Hess. Well, no marks there. See how Denis gets on. Denis, if you were handed a mirliton, what would you feel tempted to do?
I would donate it to a deserving cause. A mirliton.
Yes.
I would be.
What was that thing one used to have about a merrily totes, a hairily totes, a kiddly tripotes we used to have as a child?
Little lambsy diving.
Yes, the same sort of thing. A mirliton is something that dances.
No.
Because there is the dance of the mirlitons.
There is. I've done that.
Which occurs in a ballet. Mm-hmm. In fact, it is in the Nutcracker Suite, isn't there, a dance of the mirlitons?
You're getting rather away from the point, I'm afraid. Now, this is not...
I would dance.
M-I-R-L-I-T-O-N.
Yes. If given, handed, I said, a mirliton, I must tell you, you would probably hum through it, because it's the French version of the kazoo, like comb and paper, for instance.
I still am going to... say that there is a dance of the mirlitons.
I'm not denying it.
When I did a series of programs which are on, here comes the plug, called As You Like It, we had as one of our guests Beryl Gray, and when I asked her what she wanted as her piece of music, she said the dance of the mirlitons.
Oh, there you are, I see. And she got out her comb and paper.
You sure it wasn't... you're not confusing it with Gilbert and Sullivan, the dance of the kazookas.
Kachuka, that is. Obviously, we get some marks, don't we, for having held up the proceedings for 5 minutes.
You get fined for obstruction.
3 months.
For really no valid reason, I'll give you one out of two.
Thank you.
And listeners who've been waiting to hear from him will like to know that it's now Ian Wallace's turn. Ian, where would you find an F-hole?
Well, presumably it is a hole that either the note F comes out of or you put your finger on it in order to get the note F coming out of somewhere else.
No, it's nothing to do with the execution of any particular note.
Well, I tell you, you know in cinemas where they have those the lettering outside... You know, it tells you the name of the program. They take it down, they change it every week. Now, they've got to store those letters somewhere, right? So they store A in the A hole, and that is where you would find all the F's are in the F hole. Sure.
And then, of course, there is the instrument known as the hole.
There is.
And as in most orchestras, there is an F hole, there is a G flat hole. Mm. And actually,
you can buy them wholesale. If you...
And occasionally, you have to sit and listen to a whole concerto.
Oh, yes.
But I would still say that this is on some woodwind instrument. There is a whole.
No, I'm happy to be able to tell you, you're so wrong. You can stop now. On the belly of a violin, you would find an F-hole, or a string instrument. It allows the vibrating air inside to escape it, thereby improving the resonance, and it's shaped like a small F. Those are the two holes, one at each side of the string. That's like that, as you
really?
So rightly say, but no marks, I'm afraid. Frank, what is a harp stop?
It's a pair of wire cutters.
Was very quick. Jolly good, though. Any other ideas?
Could I have a clue, please?
Yes, harpsichord is the clue. Oh, jolly good one, too.
Stops on the harpsichord. altering the colour of the instrument.
It's a stop on the harpsichord, my large partner says, which you pull out and it changes the colour of the instrument. From brown to... Thinking of a Wurlitzer organ where they go mauve and things because they're glass.
It is, in fact, part of the action of a harpsichord, yes, which damps the strings and does sound rather like a harp. Second choice for you, so I think 1.5 out of 2 would do nicely there. There's a flourishing market, I'm told, in children's records, and we'll see how you get on with some. Here are some songs from children's records. Tell me, please, which work and which author? David.
Hum-dum-dee-dum, hum-dee-dum-dum, I'm so humbly in my tumbly. Time to munch an early luncheon, time for something sweet.
Now, it's a commercial for breakfast food.
Yes. All I can say is that I was very delicately nurtured.
What happened since?
And my parents managed successfully to keep me from knowledge of this particular piece.
Yes,
no much. What is it?
It's Rumbly in My Tumbly from an American piece, as you could tell from the accent, called Winnie the Pooh by...
Paul A. Milne.
A. Milne. Well, I'll give you 1 mark out of 2 there.
Yes. Thank you.
It came from the Disney film, Winnie the Pooh. Denis, here's a children's record for you.
It happened that a few weeks later, her aunt went up to the theater. To see the entertaining play, the second Mrs. Tanqueray.
I didn't ask you who the singer was. No. Yes, it's Owen again.
It's Hilaire Belloc, and yes. It's one of the cautionary tales.
Good enough, yes.
And I'm also told it was by Ian, it's sung by Owen Brannigan. Mm-hmm.
Yes, cautionary tales, Hilaire Belloc, mark each total 2. Ian's turn.
And every fool's a swan lad, and every lass a queen.
It's Kingsley, Charles Kingsley.
Charles Kingsley is right for a mark.
Baby? Yeah.
Yes, have a go.
I don't know where.
The book.
The Water Babies.
The Water Babies, Charles Kingsley. Frank, your turn.
I have answered 3 questions, and that is enough, said his father. Don't give yourself airs. Do you think I can listen all day to such stuff? Be off, or I'll kick you downstairs. Be off, or I'll kick you downstairs.
Old Father William.
Yes.
Lewis Carroll.
Yes, from the book.
From the book, yes. Through the...
Don't go any further. Try again.
Alice in.
Yes, that's better. Alice in the Looking Glass. Alice in Wonderland, I'll give you that. Lewis Carroll. Did you recognise the singer and don't say Joan Sutherland?
No, I didn't.
Well, it's friend Ian over there. Ian Wallace in the record. Well, 2 marks there. We press on. All the questions in this next round are to do with musicals, stage, film, or both. David, on which play was the musical Oklahoma based?
Green Grow the Rushes, I'm reliably informed.
Wrong kind of vegetation.
What?
Wrong kind of vegetation. Green Grow the...
Lilacs.
Yes. Second choice. One and a half out of 2. Denis, who was Mrs. Anna Leonowens, and what did she do?
She went to Siam and
yes.
Became governess to the king there, and or to the king's children.
Better.
And somebody called Margaret, somebody or other, wrote a book about her, which was made into a musical called The King and I, and it's the only question I have not found a puzzlement.
Anna
and the King of Siam. To you.
Yes. That's right, by Margaret Landon, actually. Two good marks there. Ian, in which musical do you find Tony, Bernardo and Riff, and whose was the most famous version of their story?
West Side Story.
Yes.
Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet.
Yes, for your other mark, thank you. Frank, Tony Martin sang Tenement Symphony in a film. Can you name the film, and who were its main stars?
No. The Marx Brothers film.
Yes, title?
Good heavens!
That came from David, didn't it?
You mean you've been to a picture? What, was it with raining or something? What drew you into the sin of, of iniquity?
Some years ago, I went to about 7 Marx Brothers films in a week. There was a festival of them on. This was, Tenement Symphony.
No, it won't get bad luck there. Well, that week's entertainment at the Biographic Glyndebourne got you a mark. Dennis, you know which film, don't you?
No, I'm trying to think.
I must tell you then, The Big Store. Well, 1 out of 2 for saying the Marx Brothers. Here's where you burst into song, gentlemen. It's the round known to the world's listeners as cotton wool time. When Graham Dalley stops playing, you go on with the tune for 1 mark, the words for another mark, and a 3rd mark for remembering to carry on where he leaves off. In other words, not going back to the beginning. 3 marks in all. And, David, we begin with a song that we offered Frank some time ago. Let's see how you get on with it.
Though it's hard to part, I know I'll be tickled to death to go. Goodbye, goodbye. Wipe a tear, baby dear, from your eye. Help, hard to part, I know. I'll be tickled to death to go. Goodbye, goodbye. Wipe a tear, baby dear, from your eye. I once went on like this for 3 days.
Yes. Good night, David Franklin. Or bonsoir, if you prefer.
Bonsoir. Yes, bonsoir.
No. Frank, would you like to finish it for him?
No.
Bonsoir, old thing.
Cheerio, chin, chin.
Toodaloo, toodaloo, goodbye.
What are the words he's missed, Frank?
And will you know, come back again.
Well, I can but give you 3 marks there. A song from Denis Norden.
Down Moonlight...
He stopped quick.
Down Moonlight Bay, we could hear the water singing. They seemed to say, "You have stolen my heart. You have stolen my heart."
Don't go away.
Where we sang love's old sweet song. Our Moonlight Bay.
You've heard of close harmony. There must be such a thing as distant harmony.
That was so close we couldn't get the harmony because we both tried to do the second.
I was wishing there was a close season for harmony.
Terrible commentary on 20th century civilization. The sort of grown men are paid money for making the...
Worse, he's paid money to say, "I don't know," to questions about opera.
Yeah.
It's a hell of a way to earn a living.
Ian, you've got a very easy one coming up. Here's your song.
You played for many months at Drury Lane. Hello, Dolly, you are so jolly.
And now you've been replaced by Auntie May.
Well, a mark, because you carried on from the right place, another mark for the tune, and shall we say half for ingenious words. Nothing like the originals, You're Looking Swell and all the rest of it. 2.5, then. Frank, your turn.
We know he is a wizard because the Wizard of Oz. And Oz is Oz is Oz because the Oz. A wizard of ever the wizard there was. Wizardy was.
And there, I'm afraid, this week's My Music ends. Sweet Revenge. The winners by 2 marks being Ian Wallace and Denis Norden. Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Race. Questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason, and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music. A musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the team.
Once again, we're back. We being Frank Muir and David Franklin playing musical men's doubles against Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. The umpire, and for preliminary knock-up, here are some familiar overtures. Just how familiar we shall now find out. A mark for the title, another mark for the composer's name, and the first to answer, David Franklin.
It's an overture to an opera by Mozart which recognizes one of life's universal truths, because the title of the piece means everybody's doing it.
Or
Così fan tutte.
Thank you, yes. 1 mark for that, 1 mark for Mozart, total 2.
Okay, total of 2.
Yes.
Thank you.
Which is all you can hope for. Good Denis start. Norden, an overture for you.
Terribly well known.
Jimmy Edwards used to play.
Yeah. Well, in that case, it's either Light Cavalry, Poet and Peasant.
Stop.
Or. Oh, right.
You got it, didn't you? Poet and Peasant, 1 mark, bye.
Ah. Oh, well, when they get that hard.
Does.
Is it. Who wrote. There was a chap called Von Suppe.
Go on. You got it.
Right?
You've got the other mark. Yeah. You've got the other mark. Yes. His real name was Francesco Escelle Ermenegildo Cavalieri Suppe de Melli. You've got 2 marks, Denis, and we hand over to your partner, Ian Wallace.
Pom, 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 yes.
You have that knowing look.
If I have a knowing look, it's because I'm concealing my ignorance much better than normally. I'm going to ask for a tiny little hint on this.
Oh, yes. Are you? I never even thought about hints for this. Well, it's a girl. It's a particular kind of girl.
A particular kind of girl?
Yes. For half a mark by a Dublin composer for another half mark.
Bohemian Girl by Balfe.
Yes, there's 2 halves making one. The Bohemian Girl by Michael William Balfe. Thank you.
Thank
and
you.
And an overture for Frank Muir. Yeah. What is it? And by whom?
It's a lovely piece of music. Written by John L. Sullivan. And
almost.
It's the overture to the Mikado, or the town of Titipu.
Yes. Yes, the Mikado, one mark, and Sullivan, Sir Arthur Sullivan, for the other mark. Now a round in which our four contestants show how much they know about the marching songs of various nations.
Ha!
David, you go, ha, let's hear from you. What was the war song of the American Confederate Army?
Oh, Marching Through Sweet Georgia Brown.
Would you like to offer us Marching Through Georgia? No,
Marching
that's not
Georgia.
Right.
Yes, I beg your pardon. The other just slipped in.
No, that's not right. This is the Confederate Army song. Can't take
that. Then it must be...
What else do we know? You served in the army.
From the Confederate Army.
He was a Yankee.
Confederate of the North, aren't they?
I don't know.
No, they're the South.
Now, I must tell you, David, the answer is Dixie. I wish I was in Dixie, that one. It was written, oddly enough, by a northerner, Daniel Emmett, who was very upset when it was adopted by the Southern cause.
As well he might be.
No marks, but well, he might be. There's a little sideline story to a number of these, which we'll see. Denis Norden, who wrote La Marseillaise and when?
When was just round about the French Revolution sometime.
Round about, yes. Give me a year.
Somewhere, well, I would say about 1792.
Absolutely correct. That was when it was written, to the precise year. Good for you. And who wrote it?
Ah. There's a very interesting story connected with this, isn't there?
Well, there is, actually. Yes.
Yeah, all right. Well, I won't hold it up. I don't know.
That's all right. Rouget de Lille. Claude Joseph Rouget de Lille. You don't know that. But the funny thing, of course, was that he was a royalist. And he, too, showed signs of being upset when he found out the thing was adapted by the wrong side, as you might say. Well, I give you one mark for 1792, and I can't give you the other mark for the composer. And he was also the author of the words. Ian Wallace, what is the Canadian national song?
The Maple Leaf.
Forever, yes.
Oh, forever, yes.
Yes, that's... or in French-Canadian areas, O Canada. Maple Leaf Forever was written, incidentally, by a...
Well, not by a maple tree, obviously.
No, I just wanted to know you were Scot.
Oh, really?
Yes, a mate of yours, a fellow Scot. Alexander Muir. You've got two marks there. Frank Muir. What was the great song of the German National Socialist Party and who wrote it?
Oh. It's not... Deutschland, Deutschland, über alles.
No.
Über alles in der Welt.
Nope.
Nine.
Horst
Vessel song.
Oh, yes, the Horst Vessel song.
Yes, I'll take that for one mark. And who wrote it?
Can I...
go on.
Draw a string at a...
Draw a string at a something, yes.
Herr Vessel.
What do you think his first name might be?
Horst.
Yes. Herr Horst Vessel. I think must give you the other mark, mustn't I? A student called Horst Vessel. He used a tune which is already a music hall favourite with the German troops in World War I. Now songs or ballads that sold a million sheet copies. Those old things. Not records, a million sheet copies. Favourites of our dads and granddads. Or in my case, great-granddads. The name of the...
Why just in your case?
Just wanted to make sure you were awake, Ian. That was all. The name of the song, please, for two marks, David.
It's the rose that I keep in my heart.
Just the name of the song, David.
Roses in Picardy.
Roses of Picardy. Got it.
Roses of Picardy.
Yes. Dennis, here's yours.
Through light and darkness, through all time to be.
It's one of those songs that's got a conjunction as a title, you know, like because and nevertheless.
Stop.
Irregardless.
Stop.
Because.
Yeah. Stop, partly because you've got it right, and also to stop you giving the answers to any of the other questions that are still to come.
Oh. Your song is called Irregardless.
Because. Two marks for Dennis. Ian's turn.
Bring on your melody of joy.
Nevertheless. Until.
Until is right for 2 marks. Thank you. Frank, you're...
Very high key that was in. Yeah, by the way. I'd have done myself a mischief if I'd gone on with that.
Frank, your turn.
Falling leaf and fading tree, night of white on a fallen sea, shadows rising to my dream, shadows rising on you and me.
Oh, it's not rotten having the verse.
Not fair.
You can get a half a point by pointing out it's not a song, but a duet. Go on, get a half a point on that.
I'll give you a mark.
Hey, Steve. Yeah. Hey. It isn't a song, it's a duet. Can I have half a mark?
I don't know what stops a duet being a song, do you?
Well, neither do I, but my mate says it's not.
I'm not wearing that. I will give you the composer, and you can give me the title for 1 mark, if you like.
Go on, hit me.
Oh, Tosti.
Tosti?
Tosti's...
Oh, goodbye!
Thank you for the other mark. Well, for 1 mark. Tosti's goodbye for a mark.
Well done.
Here are some musical meeting places. For 2 marks, David Franklin, where did the Orsinis meet the Colonnas, and on whose novel was their story based? The Orsinis met the Colonnas.
This is a musical.
Oh, yes. Oh, not on... No, I'm sorry. I thought you were going to say, is this a musical question? It's not a musical. No, it's an opera.
It's an opera.
Italian. Yes,
the Orsinis and the Colonnas.
Yes.
Come on.
I don't know.
Going. Think. Just sitting in a lump.
Now, I'll tell you one, and you can have the other mark if you guess it. I'll either tell you the opera and composer or the writer of the novel on which it was based. Which would you like? You might guess it from either. Which would you like?
The offer is to tell me the name of the opera and of the composer.
Yes. Or...
I'll take that.
You'll take that one, all right. Wagner's Rienzi, set in ancient Rome. Yeah. Who wrote the book?
Ah, that's a very good question. It was Wagner's sister-in-law called Lucy.
No, it's a lovely guess, but it wasn't. It was Bulwer Lytton, English novelist, who wrote Rienzi. And in fact, when Wagner came to England, he spent quite a lot of time roaming around trying to make contact with Bulwer Lytton to talk to him about the libretto of the opera. Well, no marks, I'm afraid. Dennis, where did Mr. McLonagan and his daughter Sharon meet Og, and who played Og in the film?
It's Finian's Rainbow.
Yes.
And who played Og in the film was... Og was the leprechaun, wasn't
That's
it?
Right.
It was Tommy Steele.
Yes.
And where did they meet? I don't know.
Well...
I don't know.
How
the end of the rainbow. Well, in Glockenmore in Ireland somewhere.
Well, yeah. That's where it all began, yes. And they met again in Rainbow Valley, USA.
In America.
Yes, in a wood, actually, they met again. 2 marks there, out of 2. Ian, the date is 50 BC. In the opera, a Roman proconsul meets a Druid priestess. Who composed the opera, and what is it called?
The year is 50 BC.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lovely day.
The sun is shining. And who is that figure we see coming in the distance? It looks very like a druid from here.
Priestess.
Yes. Oh, it's a priestess. Well, they shouldn't dress the same. You gave David a sort of tiny little hint.
Ask for a slightly larger one.
I think I'm going to need one. Any help that you can give me will be great.
Well, I'll give you one and you give me the other. I'll give you the opera and you give me the composer, all the other way around.
Give me the opera.
Norma.
Bellini.
1 mark for Bellini. Thank you. Frank, in which film did 50 men meet 1 young lady? Who were the men and who was the girl?
50's 100.
How right you are.
100 men and a lady.
Not quite.
100 men and a girl. Yes. Film.
Who were the 100 men?
Oh, they were musicians. They were a symphony orchestra.
Who?
And the girl
was
Deanna Derby.
Yes. Who's or which symphony orchestra, please?
Leopold.
Yes.
Tchaikovsky.
Yes, thank you.
Tchaikovsky.
Philadelphia Orchestra.
Depending which
platform. You've got your 2 marks with Deanna Derby in the film 100 Men and a Girl. We move on to the next round. Piano music this time. Each of these pieces has at least 2 titles. So please, can you give me 2 titles for a mark each? David Franklin, music by Mendelssohn.
Mm-hmm.
It's something to do with bees?
Yes, that'll do for one. The bees...
Can't.
B-flat minor.
Not the bee's wedding.
Yes, that
it is.
One mark for you, and one other title if you can say if you can't.
Well, the B-flat wedding.
No, you might want to.
Wait a minute.
No, I can't wait any longer, I'm afraid. Song Without Words, number 34.
That's
in C
exactly
major.
What I was going to say. I've told you before, you're much too quick. You take the words out of my mouth.
Or Spinning Song. One mark out of two. Denis, for you, music by Chopin.
Feel a knit when I don't know the answer to this type of question. You can imagine how much of a double knit I feel when there are two answers, neither of which I know. Yes.
It and you can double it up again.
Yes, you don't know either.
Well, I will contribute the one word valse for a
yes.
start.
Well, yes,
that's
that
good.
It's one of the waltzes. I'll give you half a mark.
Shrewd.
I'll give you half a mark.
Yes. And well, it is in the minor key,
yes,
which makes us think that it is rather sad.
But it doesn't necessarily follow, but still.
No, it doesn't necessarily
happens
follow.
To be in a minor key,
but
yes.
it happens to be in a minor key.
Would you like the other... Could you give me the key? You probably couldn't.
No, I haven't got the perfect pitch.
No.
But,
no, no.
I would suggest that it might be B-flat.
No, you're a minor third out. It's C-sharp. Waltz in C-sharp minor, number 7, opus 64. I'll give you half a mark there. Another mark, if you can tell me, it occurred also in something else, as well as in that piece.
Occurred in something else?
Yes. If you don't know, we'll...
No, we'll just get on. Let's
also in the ballet Les Sylphides, music based on the on music by Chopin, yes. Of course.
It also occurs in Gems from Chopin.
Chopiniana. Ian, yours is by Schumann, and I've got four titles listed here, so you should be able to name two of them. Here we go.
Would Andy Musique be one of them?
No, wrong composer, I'm afraid.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Schubert, isn't it?
Wrong everything, yes.
I thought Schumann might have pinched it as well.
No, only the first three letters of the name. Four.
The first two notes are like So Deep Is the Night.
Yes, I thought we were all right there. Yes, I thought we were one up and three to go there.
All this is mere shilly-shally.
Yes, it is. Just in the hope that we're going to pick up
half
of them.
You don't know.
No, I don't know.
Well, then...
I know the piece very well.
Traumerei, or Dreaming, or Reverie, or even what it comes from, Scenes of Childhood. Usually known as Traumerei.
Yes.
By Schumann, no marks. Frank Muir, back for you to Mendelssohn.
Where's the title?
I think you're on the right track.
I'm advised. It's another song without words.
Yes, that's one.
By Mendelssohn.
Yes.
That's another mark.
No, it isn't. And the other title?
It's Mendelssohn's Spring Song.
Spring Song for the other mark. Some odds and ends of musical knowledge. David. Where? David, where is Tin Pan Alley?
That, to me, is the end of musical knowledge. Tin Pan Alley is in the Charing Cross Road.
It isn't.
Not.
It's off the Charing
Cross. Off the Charing Cross Road.
Yes. The name of the street.
Denmark Street.
Yes, Denmark Street is right, off Charing Cross Road. And there's also one in New York, of course, between 5th and 6th Avenues on 28th Street in New York City. Two marks, anyway. Denis, what are sympathetic strings?
Sympathetic... Strings. are strings which are very kind to a lost chord.
Sympathetic strings, then. Can you think of an instrument that has sympathetic strings?
An instrument that has sympathetic strings would have strings that would sort of make the same noise as something else that is making at the same time.
The mandolin has two strings to every note, so they must be in sympathy with one another, but it's obviously a harmonic thing.
I think you've got the right... I must give you the 2 marks, really, because you've got the idea. Extra strings, as on a sitar, for instance. Not played on, but strings allowed to vibrate in sympathy with the plucked strings. Uh-huh. 2 marks. Ian Wallace, what is... And I rather hope you'll demonstrate this instead of describing it. What is portamento?
Well, it's the thing that doctors in the old days used to bring the instruments in. Sometimes musical instruments, even, if they were musical doctors. But it is also, in my neck of the woods, something which is marked on the music as an effect to be done, but is sometimes performed by singers inadvertently in trying to reach certain notes with a sort of... In other words, it is a beautiful scooping, either upwards or downwards. Composers occasionally ask for it by putting a little mark in the shape of a sort of bit of a circle, but more often than not, it is something which critics are lambasting singers for doing in the wrong place.
And orchestras, too.
And orchestras too.
I think when the Philharmonia Orchestra had a
from one to another.
Yes, that's right.
One note to another.
Frank, if you were playing the violin, where would your node be?
It's a catch question, this. If I were playing the violin, where would my node be?
Has this got anything to do with the strings?
Of course it has.
Ah, then, Frank, I think we're home. Keep his attention.
There's no time to draw a diagram.
Yes, there is. It's that point. It's after this is where the fingers are.
He's drawing
are.
A flattened
it's
figure
the other
eight,
side
I think. Yes.
Of the bridge.
Ah. Now, if a string vibrates, it can only vibrate in a free area.
Yes. It's the point on the string where the vibration is least, a stationary point with waves on either side, like a sort of flattened figure eight, you might
Where's
say.
That?
That's where the node is.
Well, where is it?
I don't know where it is, but it's 2 marks for you anyway.
Well, I'm supposed to know where it is. Neither do you know where it is. Really?
Well, they never know where anything is on a violin. That's why they keep sliding their fingers up and down.
Try and find it. No party is complete without a sing-song. In this, our contestants get a mark for the tune, another mark for the words, and a third bonus mark for remembering to continue where Graham Dalley leaves off, not going back to the beginning of the song. First to dig for gold is David Franklin. And David, this, I warn you, is the verse, not the chorus.
Excavating for a mine, dwelt a miner, 49er, and his daughter Clementine. Oh, my darling, this is the chorus and not the verse. Oh, my darling, oh, my darling, oh, my darling Clementine, thou art lost and gone forever, dreadful sorry Clementine.
Rosy
ducklings near the water.
No more, I beg you. And 1 mark is knocked off if you sing too many verses. No, 3 marks, David. Very nice, thank you. Denis, song for you.
Smile, though your heart is breaking. Smile for a while, though you're tired.
It's written by Charlie Chaplin.
Well,
oh,
yes.
You don't want any more.
It picked up Smile Even Though It's Breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you will get by, and so on. Mm. Frank, your song.
Well, your left foot out. Otherwise, you'll trip over. Your left foot in, and you shake it all about. You do the hokey-cokey and turn about. That's what it's all about. Oh!
Yes, I think that's good enough for 3 marks. Ian, your song.
You You look neat, such a treat. You look dapper from your napper to your feet. Dressed in style, brand new tie, with your father's old green tie on. But I wouldn't give you tuppence for your watch and chain. Old iron, old iron, any old iron, any old iron, any old iron. You look neat, such a treat. You look dapper from your feet.
And our show ends there with a victory by 1.5 marks for David Franklin and Frank Muir.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Race. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason and the program was produced in London by Tony Schreier. The BBC presents My Music, a musical panel game devised by Edward J. Mason and Tony Schreier. And here's Steve Race to introduce the teams.
Once again, My Music takes the stand with four expert witnesses: Frank Muir and David Franklin, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. I am the judge, and I have in front of me a jury, known as the audience, to ensure that my mercy is occasionally tempered with justice.
You don't want to keep it for minutes.
Martial, inspiring music to begin with. A mark for the title and another mark for the name of the composer, David Franklin.
I'm very grateful for your observations. You were kind enough to tell me that this was martial music, as this is the entry of the Queen of Sheba. May I ask, my lad, who she was going to fight?
The Earl Marshal.
Marshal-sounding music. You have a mark there. You know what it comes from and who it's by.
Well, it's the entry of the Queen of Sheba, yes. From by Handel.
Yes, from Solomon. Absolutely right for two marks. Martial-sounding music, and indeed martial music, for Denis Norden.
This brings back to me is summer holidays spent at Brighton around the bandstand and somebody saying, I think there's a bit of sun coming up over Rottingby. It's one of those which one grew up with this tune and has never bothered to inquire what it's called. I'm terribly sorry, Steve, I don't know.
It's from a musical.
It's from a musical.
Yes, I must tell you then, March of the Toys from Babes in Toyland by the father of the American musical, as he's been called.
Rombo?
No.
Frimmel?
Further back. Victor Herbert. Mm. Can't give you any marks there. Ian Wallace, your turn. Yeah.
haven't the faintest idea. But I think I would have a guess, a wild guess, and say in a monastery garden by Cattelby.
No, just
to show I knew the name of something.
No. A composer of greater repute, really, than that. Shall I give you the title and you give me the composer?
Well, why not?
Salut d'amour.
Martial music, you understand? Yeah.
The composer.
Now give me the composer.
Elgar. And whatever happened to our martial music, I really don't know.
Well, Elgar was born in March.
We're back with the martial music for Frank Muir.
See it.
They're going through agonies, those two.
Yes.
I know it's film music. Yes, it's film music.
It's,
for you.
Shape of Things to Come, Sir Arthur Bliss.
Yes, Sir Arthur Bliss. March from Things to Come. General musical knowledge. David, what would you do if you saw the letters DC on a piece of music?
I saw the letters what?
DC.
DC.
On a piece of music. What would you do?
I go back to some other point and repeat part of it.
Choose a point you might go back to.
Oh, well, I go back to the double bar.
No, choose another point.
That's easy. What?
Choose another point.
Oh, I go up to the top.
Yes, go back to the beginning. All right. You've won your way through to that one. Those letters DC stand for the words da capo, from the head, meaning go back to the start again. All right, 2 marks. Denis, if I gave you a bladder and string and asked you to perform, what would you do?
I presume that I would have to do something musical with it.
Exactly.
I think I would hit Ian with it till I made him sing. Right. Have you ever performed bladder and string? Ian Wallace accompanied by bladder and string. Yes. It sounds like a firm of solicitors.
Yes.
Or a state agent.
Or fiddle player doubling bladder and string.
Well, how funny you should say that. Yes.
This seems to me to be something where you would hold the string out very taut and play it with a bow. With the bladder between your knees. Yeah. You're never going to believe this. Yeah. Or else you take the string and go, boom! And let it hit the bladder at different, boom, boom. You can imagine it, you playing that piece that goes la da 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 pum 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 pum.
I mean, with a string and what was a bladder.
Yes.
Yes, I was just a thought generous with David. I'll be just a thought generous with you. You're quite right for 2 marks. You would fix the bladder onto a pole, stretch the string over it, finger with the left hand and bow with the right. You'd make, a kind of primitive...
But I did say I would play it with the bow.
Yes, kind of primitive double bass. Yes. You've got 2 marks.
Thank you.
Ian's turn. Ian, on the subject of opera, what is a soap opera and why is it so called?
A soap opera is usually an opera without any music at all. And it lasts either quarter of an hour or half an hour, according to how much the sponsors can afford to pay. Called, really, because in America it was done as an episodic serial each day to advertise soap.
Yes, 2 marks. A radio or TV serial story of a sentimental nature, originally American, sponsored by soap manufacturers, it says here. 2 marks. Frank, a two-part question for you. What does a trombonist do with his left hand... And from which medieval instrument did it develop?
I'll take the first question first.
Right.
With his right hand, he slithers backwards and forwards, doesn't he?
That's correct, yes.
And with his left hand, he opens his first and second fingers in a sort of horizontal derogatory gesture, thereby pressing the instrument to his lips. Because if his lips go away from the instrument... No noise, but a raspberry emerges. So, in other words, he, in fact, holds the instrument to his lips with his left hand.
That's right, with forefinger curled over the mouthpiece. That's 1 mark. Now, from which medieval instrument did the trombone develop?
Well, you get a bladder and a... A what? How do you know that?
I just happen to know this.
My friend says Sackbutt.
Sackbutt is right for your other mark.
There you are, you see.
Can we very briefly know what a Sackbutt is?
It's a medieval trombone.
Back in your minds, gentlemen, to the early films, early musicals. At any rate, earlier than what passes for a film musical these days. David, a short, simple question with, let us fervently hope, a short, simple answer. Who sang Rio Rita?
Ben Lyon.
I was going to say Baby Daniels.
Yes, a lovely answer, that, for 2 marks. Thank you. Denis Norden, what did Adam tell his 6 brothers to do, and what gave him the basic idea?
Well, it's 7 brides for 7 brothers, and he told them to go and grab themselves some women from a town nearby. And what gave him the basic idea was what he described as the sobbing women.
Yes.
But were actually the Sabine women.
Yes. Reading Plutarch's Lives is supposed to be what gave him the idea in the film.
Yeah.
Anyway, you've got 2 marks. Good. Ian, who told the girls to keep young and beautiful, and in which film?
Roman Scandals.
Roman Scandals is the film.
Yes, and the singer.
we tried to look as if I thought of it myself. And that marvellous descriptive gesture makes me realise it must be Mr. Eddie Cantor.
Yes, that's right. Roman Scandals, Eddie Cantor, 2 marks. Frank, if I had a talking picture of Yoo-Hoo, who wanted a talking picture of Hoo-Hoo and in which film?
I had a talking picture. Keep your sunny side up.
Yes.
By the sky that gets blue.
That's the
this
film.
Is my era. Janet Gaynor, Charles Farrell.
Yes, that's yes. Right. That's right, for 2 marks. Do you, for interest, know the year in which that film was?
I would say about 1931.
No, a bit before that, 1929. Anyway, you've got your marks. Now for some music that paints a picture or tells a story. Can you describe, please, for 2 marks, the scene you see when you hear these bits of music? David.
Got it. Jolly good show, chaps. Jolly good turnout, stirrup cups, tally-ho, and away, there she blows.
Blows? Got a bit nautical at the end.
Moby Dick and other well-known hunting stories. Well, yes, yes. Hunting, isn't it? Yes.
Hunting.
Yes, they're quite right, for 2 marks. It's the composer called it Hunt in the Black Forest. Dennis.
Yes, I bought back a cigarette box that played like that. They sell them on the beach in Italy. It's kind of 18th century figurine of a lady saying something like, "Lawks, Lord Worthington, how you do run on. Will you have my postillion brought round to the front?"
And struck by lightning.
Yes. In an 18th century fish shop.
Very nice too, yes. 2 marks. It's called, by it's very worthy composer of the Adolf. It was called A Musical Snuff Box. Oh, very good. Ian, bring your towering intellect to bear on this.
Oh, this must be one of those delightful scenes that everybody hopes they can arrange on the continental holiday where they manage to organise that the chap comes along with this beautiful old-fashioned horse carriage and takes them through the Vienna woods, clip-clopping and the sun shining. Ride in a carriage through the woods.
I make it a point to give everybody 2 marks in this round. But so you've got 2 marks, but you missed a major element in that. That sound of the audience heard. Clocks, yes. It was called In a Clock Store.
Oh.
And you missed all the tick-tockery of that. Frank Muir, here's your music.
extraordinary tune, isn't it?
Yes.
It is never... Nobody ever buys a record of this or listens to it. Its only use is to be danced at.
Yes.
By a chap in a beret and a fisherman's shirt and a girl in fish net stockings with a split up to her armpit. And they dance in front of extras pretending to drink at a cafe table.
Yes.
And he slings her about and she hits him with a tin tray, which incidentally doesn't hurt. Anybody can do that. There's no trick. And she eventually... He treats her rather vilely in the dance. Yes. And eventually she exits with him over her shoulder. It's called the Apache dance.
It really is. Yes, Apache. Two marks. Two marks.
Yes. If you imagine the announcement being put out on the BBC tomorrow... We've had complaints from listeners that children have taken to hitting their parents with tin trays. Having been assured by Frank Muir that it does.
Kiddies, it's got to be a real tin tray. Don't do it with the oak one or the glass one.
Well, two marks anyway. The idea of performers having signature tunes is generally thought to have been started by the late Albert Whelan, music hall star, who used to come on whistling a tune called Lustige Brüder, Jolly Brothers. As Frank so ably demonstrates, yes. Well, now, of course, singers, comedians, bands, and even football teams have their theme songs or signature tunes. This programme has one, come to think of it. Two marks if you can name the signature tune of David, Edith Piaf.
Who?
Edith or Edith Piaf. Yeah. Name the signature tune, please.
It's an Indonesian dish.
What you say? Poor people of Paris... Can you my friend, or say bye? You my friend, you bye.
Yes, that was the signature.
What was it called, David?
What was it called?
It's la vie en rose, which means red meat.
La vie en rose, you got it anyway, eventually, with the aid of your mate, David. Two marks there. Dennis, what was Tommy Dorsey's signature tune?
Now you're not only mate. Area, but my era. He was known as the sentimental gentleman of swing, because
yes.
His signature tune was I'm Getting Sentimental Over You.
Yes, for two marks. Ian, your era too, perhaps. Cab Calloway's signature tune.
Maybe my era, but not my area.
Meaning the mood.
But I often have to acknowledge this wonderful information service, which has come across with an unexpected title, not the sort of title that turns up in the operatic part of my life. I've never heard of an aria, for example, called Minnie the Moocher. They call me Minnie.
They call me Minnie the Moocher. Yes. Minnie the Moocher for two marks. Frank Muir, if you haven't seen them in person, you must have seen them many times on TV. The signature tune, please, of the Harlem Globetrotters.
Oh, thank you. It's not... Oh, yes, wait a minute. It's, Only a Rose. Warm?
No, as cold as can be. They always come on to the same tune, and they do a warm-up.
Yeah, it's always the same record.
Yes, of course.
The whistling one.
Dennis is whistling it for you. Whistle it, Dennis.
See, I can whistle.
Yes.
He's a great little siffleur, my mate.
Sour Georgia Brown.
One mark out of two because you had help from the other side over
there. Oh, I wouldn't say that.
Sweet Georgia Brown, the record they use is by Bones, Brother Bones and his brothers. Well, those were signature tunes. Now for theme music, main title music, as they call it, from well-known films. One mark for the title of the film, another two marks for naming two stars from the film. David.
And the river itself.
Yes, the river itself.
You get an extra mark for that.
Yes, I've got four marks coming up here.
Out of three.
Bridge over. Well, it's a big moment for me. I actually recognise something from a film. Bridge over the River Kwai.
Bridge on the River Kwai, yes. One mark.
That's one mark lost
on the River Kwai.
And eventually the bridge
under the River Kwai.
the last 100 feet.
All right. Right. Yeah. The bridge on the River Kwai. You're very pedantic tonight, Mr. Race.
One needs to be. With
Stars. Will you take Alec Guinness and William Holden?
Yes, lovely.
And the music was by Malcolm Arnold.
Well, yes, but not that too.
Well, no, that's an arrangement by Malcolm Arnold of a very old folk song.
With traditional words.
don't go any further, because you're getting more incorrect as you go on. Okay. March by Kenneth Alford. Anyway, you've got your marks there, Sir Alec Guinness, William Holden, Bridge on the River Kwai. 1, 2, 3 marks. Denis, your film.
Wasn't this the opening music of Tom Jones?
You're right. Good for you. Yeah. I never thought you'd get it.
Because they only played that in that sort of speeded up silent.
That's
bit,
right.
Wasn't it?
Good for you. Two stars, please, from the film.
Oh, what's his name? Yeah, Albert Finney and Hugh Griffiths and Joan Greenwood and Susanna York.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, they'll do nicely for 3 marks. Ian, your turn.
This is An American in Paris.
Yes, 1 mark.
With Gene Kelly.
Yes, this is another mark.
And Leslie Caron.
Another mark, thank you. 3. Yes, 3 marks. Film for Frank.
It's a Tom and Jerry cartoon. Clue, please.
Oh, clue? Oh, I don't give clues in this round.
Oh, well.
Well, I'll give you a clue. Yes, one of the stars in the film was named after a cup of coffee.
No, shoot me.
No, well, the name I had in mind was Cappuccino. Like cappuccino, but...
Oh, that's a good clue, there. Thank you.
Next week, ask that as a question.
Also, Claudia Cardinale, also... David Niven and Peter Sellers.
The Pink Panther.
Yes, but I can't give you that, can I?
Well, I never saw it. How do you expect me to know the thing when I never saw it?
You don't need the marks anyway. Well, Pink Panther was right, and Peter Sellers and David Niven were the main stars. It's often said that singing keeps you cheerful. Not the kind of singing we hear now, perhaps. Graham Dalley plays the beginning of a song. Our contestants continue with 1 mark for the tune, another for the words, and a 3rd mark for carrying on where he leaves off, instead of going back to the start, which is easier. These are all wartime songs. So, David, come out fighting.
Take me, da-da-da, take me anywhere. Liverpool, Leeds or Manchester, well, I don't care. Oh, I should like to see my best girl. Something or other again, we soon should be... Highty diddly highty, hurry me back to Blighty. Blighty is the place for me.
3 marks. Thank you. To the wartime song, Denis.
Rendezvous, mademoiselle from Armentières hasn't been kissed for 40. I was going to say that. Sorry. For 40 years. Hinky dinky parlez-vous. Very simple.
It's not really my war. Yeah.
Never mind, you're absolutely right. We all know, of course, you're right. 3 marks for Denis. Ian Wallace.
It's a long way to Tipperary, to the sweetest girl I know. Goodbye, Piccadilly. Farewell, Leicester Square. It's a long, long way to Tipperary, but my heart's right there.
Yes, yes, for 3 marks. And a song, wartime song, for Frank.
I make it clear it wasn't my war. Something tells me I must leave you to the front to fight the foe. Fleas are coming up the garden, and I can no longer stay. Cock, I hear Cock. The bugle call. Goodbye, Johnny Ray.
And there, I'm afraid, this week's My Music ends with a victory by 1 mark for Ian Wallace and Denis Norden.
Goodbye.
Taking part in My Music were David Franklin, Frank Muir, Denis Norden and Ian Wallace. Graham Dalley was at the keyboard and the chairman was Steve Race. The questions were compiled by Edward J. Mason and the programme was produced in London by Tony Schreier.